is you're here to speak about Jesus Christ first and foremost. So you know, we go through life and God raises people up in mysterious and strange ways. And so whatever we're doing in our careers and in our life and what our mission in life is and our purpose and our ministry, it's always first and foremost about Jesus. You know, I had Tracy on my podcast last year, and one of the things I remember her telling me is that she wrote her book, she became a Christian, Jesus saved her, she decided to leave her career in Hollywood as an actor, she wrote this book, and she told me that when she went on to Larry King to promote the book, she said it was her coming out party because she knew that by going on Larry King to speak about her faith and the book that her career was over. And I guess it might have been over in as far as Hollywood standards are concerned. I know she's still doing a lot of great things as far as film and acting and producing and writing books and things like that. But first and foremost, God used her from that community and that industry to raise her up, to be here tonight, to give her testimony first and foremost. Amen?
Amen.
And secondly, Lindsay, someone said to me when I was in the lobby today, they said, yeah, Lindsay, she got run out of town for the state for her beliefs. And they were telling me, my son kept his business open, and he didn't receive any threats or anything, and they just let him stay open, and he stood strong, and they left him alone, and they didn't run him out of town like they ran Lindsay out of town, right? And I said, they didn't just run her out of town, they ran her out of the entire state, right? So you gotta be doing something that makes the devil really angry.
Yeah.
Right? Getting kicked out of the entire state, that's pretty impressive. That's pretty impressive. Okay, so where's Trace? Oh, there you are. So Tracy, Lindsay, Melchior. Come on up.
Okay. He's whispering, but he has a microphone.
Look at this crowd. Impressive. I was worried you guys would have
some. Great pleasure to welcome Tracy Lindsay Melchior to Larry King. Well, I have a lot of people with three names. The former star of daytime TV's Bold and the Beautiful and One Life to Live.
It took almost as long for us to decorate our house as it took Dave to make Parker.
Which is why I had to make Parker. See, honey, one was supposed to happen before the other. So, did you hear back from New York about the bike business?
Yeah, I'm gonna go with a small investment bank firm.
Nina, this grouper is amazing. Peter caught it in Mexico. Have you ever gone on one of those famous fishing trips?
No, I would. They stay at a different hotel. There's no pole fishing, no phones. We had to call for room service.
No phones, we talk every day.
I'm myself.
Well, Peter, I called you.
Yeah, I'm myself, honey. Remember?
So how come phone didn't work at 1 in the morning?
Different carrier.
Loves me. He wants to marry me.
Is that what you want?
I want to serve him.
I think not think otherwise.
I think I'm under God's judgment.
No, you're not.
I feel like he's taking everyone that I love away from me to punish me. First my parents, and now Chris.
Why on earth would God want to punish you?
I've never told anyone that I had an abortion.
How is Thorne? Is he excited?
You have got to see him with this little baby.
I can't wait. I always knew that he would be a great dad.
Mm-hmm.
And Rich?
Oh, he's fine.
Mother?
Mm-hmm.
Brooke is getting married today. I know Ridge is not fine.
Well, he will be once he accepts the idea of the marriage and moves on.
restrained, considering. I half expected to find you dancing in the streets. Come on, I know how long you have wanted this. You have wanted Brooke to cut ties with this family ever since the day she married into it. Why haven't you left?
I was hoping you were gonna come back. Did you forget something?
Did you steal that?
He left from the table.
Oh, God, I saw his insecurity get away from here, Ugly Butt.
So, tell me about the look on Kevin's face when you told him that Blair was getting married.
David.
Come on, what's up with that house in the years, huh? Tell me all about it, you know. Does he have a thing for your cousin, or do you think she's got a thing for him?
David, that is ridiculous, okay? And it is none of your business, so why don't you just butt out of my marriage?
Tracy Lindsay Melchior, the former star of Bold and the Beautiful and One Life to Live. Heartily, I wish you the best.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. And thank you all for coming tonight.
And scene. No, thank you guys all for coming out to hear my story, which is God's story. But that is a little bit about, you know, my stage work. But I wanted to kind of talk to you guys, one, about what led me to wanting to be on stage, and then what led me to this stage tonight. So it's not really that unique of a story. Girl grows up, you know, a lot of people that are drawn to Hollywood are drawn for similar reasons. It's a desperate need for attention and approval, a need to be heard and seen when you don't feel like you were as a child. My parents were divorced when I was 5. Not unique, right? A lot of, unfortunately, divorce in our world, and I really hope that that can change. I think that is a huge key to a lot of the problems. But they were divorced at 5, and my mother had 3 children. She was 22 years old, 3 kids under the age of 5. And she moved us to Colorado. I was born in Hollywood, Florida, ironically. I was on the wrong coast, but she moved us to Colorado, where her parents were, to get away from my dad. And she basically dropped us off at my grandparents' house, and I honestly did not recognize my mom when she walked in the garage after that. It took me a minute to know who she was. She went to find herself or whatever it was she needed to do, and I'm gonna kind of like skirt through all this really quick, but when I was 10, my grandfather died from type 1 diabetes. I remember in school learning that type 1 diabetes has a 25% of passing on, and it skips a generation, and I was the 4th grandchild. So I spent so much of my life in fear of diabetes, and I think that helped me like find a healthier path in life with my nutrition. But my grandmother decided when my grandfather died that she didn't want to raise my mom's kids anymore. So my mom at that point had met my stepdad, who was a newscaster in Colorado. And he was quite famous in Colorado. I did the 5 and 10 o'clock news, which was pretty cool for me. But I remember when my mom told us about him, it was basically she showed us him on the news, that this was her new guy. And I remember thinking, wow, he has had all her attention. If I could figure out a way to get in that box, maybe I would have my mom's attention. And I didn't realize it at the time that that would be the path I would end up in. But then when I was in 7th grade, my stepdad gave my mom her lifelong dream of owning a horse ranch. And they moved us to this teeny tiny little town in Elizabeth, Colorado. And we had a 40-acre ranch. Now, some of you guys have property out here, and you know how it is. You give a woman a big barn, she's gonna fill it, 40 acres. My mom just started like insanely getting more and more animals. If you saw, I was also on Dr. Phil about her. She's a hoarder, so you can look that up too. whole other thing, like Dr. Phil level. They didn't even think that when they were moving there, halfway through a semester of 7th grade meant I was going to a new small town school in 7th grade, and The only elective class that had an opening was drama. This is when I was convinced God hated me. Everything else was like, God must hate me, right? How we think sometimes in our life. And I was like, gosh, I'm going to do drama of all things. And how many things in our life, you guys, look, now I've made a career out of it. How many times, like, does something seem like the worst thing happening to you? And it's not. It's a blessing in disguise. And it was. I fell in love with acting. I loved learning what makes people tick. And it's like understanding yourself, too, right? Like, I wanted understanding. I wanted things to make sense in my life because nothing made sense. So we moved there. I ended up... I was going to do it off this, but I can't even see it anymore. My eyes are... So bear with me. Anyway, so then I ended up going. I went to high school. I continued in drama through high school. But along the path, when my mom and... a part I skipped was my stepdad was a nice enough guy, but he had that, which a lot of stepdads do, unfortunately, is I'm not raising someone else's children. And so he made really good money. I mean, he did very well, but my mom rented a little house for us girls, and she spent most of her time with him. And I skipped a lot of meals, I skipped a lot of school, I skipped a lot of showers, quite honestly. I was just a stinky little kid. my life stunk and I stunk, what can I say? But it led to a lot of vulnerabilities. It made me vulnerable. And, you know, I was so desperate for love, attention, affection, validation, all of those things. And it led to all the kind of things that you guys all can conclude from that. And unfortunately, like, my oldest sister, I was 12, and she had, like, a high school party at our house. And, you know, one of the boys came and found me at 12 years old, you know. Oh, I swear I'm not going to cry. Can I tell this?
It's okay.
Thank you.
You're not alone, girl.
We got you.
Anyway, my hand still bears the scar of being pressed into the carpet and the nail on the carpet. And I was 12 years old. And so it makes you feel worthless. But what I said to myself was, had his attention for a minute. And it led to a life of thinking that was my value. I mean, he left a party, he wanted to come with me. This is where my value is. And that led to not great decisions. You know, when you're desperate for something, the way I like to explain how we make bad decisions when we're desperate is if you're dying of thirst, a little bit like I am right now. Thank you. When you're thirsty, right, you're willing to not drink out of a pretty bottle with the, you know, pictures of streams and oceans, right? You'll drink dirty water, right, because you're so thirsty. Or you'll drink salt water. Well, salt water is like sin, right? It looks good. You're thirsty. You think it's quenching your thirst, but you'll always be thirsty, right? It will never truly satisfy you because it's salt water. And so I was making poor decisions out of that desperate need for approval, validation, credit, and to matter. And so I went through high school, graduated high school, went to college at Colorado State University. I was so excited. But my mom didn't pay my tuition. I got red slipped. I went out of there and ended up with a boyfriend 5 years older than me. I don't know how I picked this guy. But like I said, I was drinking from a dirty pond, okay? At 18 years old, I found myself pregnant, and I was freaked out, completely freaked out, because this was not a good relationship. I was being a bank teller, and this guy convinced me that he would pay for half of it if I took care of it. He was so generous. He split it. If I came up with the other half, and then he convinced me that because he did steroids, he was a bodybuilder, if he did steroids, that it would I was doing the right thing because there probably was something wrong with it. So I believed all the lies that it's just cells, all of those things. And I remember walking to the clinic that day, and there was a lady out there. I wish I could find her and let her know now where how this all ended up, because God bless her. You know, she had the little, this is how big your baby is right now. I'm like, lady. I just didn't believe her. I wasn't ready to hear. I was so busy wanting to be heard, I wasn't hearing. And I didn't hear God. I was so wanting him to hear me, but I never heard him. And anyway, so I left that a couple days later, I had severe stomach pain. My stomach hurt so bad. And with all my mom's faults, if I call my mom and say, I need you now, she'll show up. You know, she doesn't think of it on her own like I think she should, but if I need her, she'll show up. And so my mom showed up with Taco Bell. Now, anybody who knew me, a Burrito Supreme and a Taco Supreme and a Pepsi cured everything. I mean, my friends, when I was modeling, you guys, I used to model as a laundry and swimmer, and my friends got me a shirt that said Body by Taco Bell. But she showed up with it and I wouldn't eat it. I kid you not, she goes, I'm calling the doctor. I was like, so anyway, they rushed me to the emergency room. Come to find out I had peritonitis. If you guys know what that is, a severe infection all through my entire reproductive system. I had to sign a waiver that said that if they might have to take my ovaries, my uterus, everything, the infection so bad that I had to sign that I knew that they were possibly doing that. Oh, and I was like, again, God hates me. It was instant punishment for my abortion. He hated me. And so I remember waking up after my belly was so swollen, and I looked at this nurse who was just a saint of a lady, and I was like, well? And she goes, no, girl, they didn't have to take it. You're fine. And I was like, I just started sobbing, and I was like, oh my gosh. And I said something about, you know, God hates me. And she's like, no, hon, God doesn't hate you. God forgave you, and you got to forgive yourself. And I, you know, there were just these little, like when I look back at the curriculum of my life and all the people, you know, one of my favorite sayings, I think it's Billy Graham, it's this, it takes 40 people to lead someone to Christ. The first one thinks they did nothing. The last one thinks they did everything. And they're both wrong. And, you know, she was one of the along the way. So from there, it took me, it's embarrassing, about 2 years to finally leave this guy. Because, you know, when you feel worthless, you accept, again, dirty pond water. But after him using my credit cards and then using my credit cards to buy me flowers, to apologize for using my credit card. Oh, I just thought I'd add enough one day. I got up, I moved, I'm like, I'm going to California. So I moved to California, ended up, how am I on time? Because I feel like I'm rambling. Okay, there we go. I moved to California, called a girlfriend of mine from high school theater. She's like, I don't have, or no, I stayed, okay, I'm sorry. I stayed with my sister who had moved out there and her husband. They're like, we don't have room for you, but my father-in-law, you can stay there. Again, the father-in-law comes into my room. I just, you know, if you ever want to talk about stuff, I'm like, it's 9 o'clock at night. Why are you in my bed? So I left there, needless to say, and I called my girlfriend from high school, and she's like, I got a floor if you want it. I'm like, I'll take your floor over this mansion I was living in with this psychologist guy, because on that. So I was, I pursued my dream of Hollywood. I was finally in Hollywood, and I, but I couldn't get work right away, so I was a receptionist for a while. And then I started teaching aerobics, and then I ended up modeling. And my first modeling agency was a lady named Irina Kamal from the Playboy Modeling Agency. Mm-hmm. I don't know how that ended up, but anyway, so my career started going. I started picking up there. And I ended up falling into a little bit of the casting couch stuff out there, you know, and you don't even realize it's happening. But it's there. It's so prevalent. I did go on there, what was I? Oh, Hannity talking about that. I want to hear a little bit more about the casting couch stuff. But I was so desperate for that validation, that credit, the approval, and, you know, success. And I just want to tell you guys, Trump is right. Okay, women, when a billionaire walks in the room, they really do what he said. That's what was going on in Hollywood. It is prevalent. And, you know, you have this combination of girls, there's probably 10,000 of them crossing the border into California right now, who are desperate for that same thing they didn't get at home. And men who are willing to, you know, exploit that. So I got married to, my first husband, my first starter husband, I met in the bar. I actually met all my husbands in bars. There's only two, but I met them both in bars. anyway, I wasn't ready to be married, but quite honestly, I loved his mom. I wanted her to be my mom, and so I just wanted family, and he had just like a cool family. But I wasn't loyal to him, I gotta be honest. I was still doing the casting couch life. I was still, you know, going to parties, didn't want him to come, that sort of thing. And he knew more than I realized he knew, but it wasn't until he had a skiing accident, which damaged the front part of his brain. He was airlifted off Big Bear slopes, and I remember going to the hospital again and thinking, oh my gosh, God hates me. I thought he was gonna die, he looks awful. And I remember telling God, please just, I'll be a better wife. I don't do this, just I'll be a better wife. And when he woke up, he spoke in a full Southern accent, born and raised in California. told me, get myself a woman. And I'm like, who is this? And when it was time for him to go from the hospital, the doctor said he has the capacity of a man, but the mind of a child. And it's gonna be kind of like he's drunk all the time. And he said, you shouldn't take him home alone. So we stayed with his parents for a while. Eventually I took him home alone, but the doctor was right. My ex ended up getting very violent. And I remember one night I was running out of the house. I could just feel the wave coming down the hallway. And I knew, you better get your butt out of here. And I ran out to my car, and just as I was about to close that car door, he slammed it open so hard he put a dent from his motorcycle in the car door. And he dragged me back inside, and it had gotten pretty dark by then, and he was telling me all the reasons he was gonna kill me and how he was gonna kill me and all of these things. And all of a sudden, this bright light shines in the back sliding door. And it was the police. And my neighbor had heard my screams and called the police. And now I know, like, the light coming in the darkness, the symbolism of it was just like God showing up again. But again, I didn't totally see and hear him yet. And my ex went to jail. He never forgave me for me giving him a felony. It took me 5 years of apologizing to realize, wait, he's never apologized. That's how, like, pathetic I was and felt so worthless, right? Like, I was like, please forgive me. I'm like, what am I doing? Anyway, I went to counseling to try and save that marriage. And after it, you know, was going nowhere, I said, I'm going to stay in counseling because I want to do this again. I want to do it better. And my counselor, I'll never forget, it's a secular counselor. We got to a point in counseling, he's like, yeah, you need a foundation because I got nothing I can build on. Like, you have no faith in the world at all. And so he sent me out church shopping. And I went the New Age way. I went all these different ways. But Christianity, remember, I wanted things to make sense. It just makes sense. Everything made sense about it. And so I was pointing my feet in that direction. And he said, okay, so what do you want in a husband? And I listed off things like honor, integrity, stability, reliability, character, all of these things. And he's like, yeah, that guy won't marry you. He's like, he'll date you, but he won't marry you. So we got some work to do. And I was like, I'm rolling up my sleeves. I'm down for it. And he took me out. He made me do a dating detox. I wasn't allowed to date. And I worked with him for a long time, and then I loved country dancing, and I would still go out dancing. That was my workout. And one night, one of my dance partners was like, let's go on a little road trip, go to a different club. then this guy shows up. I'm on front. He walks in, and I was like, I kid you guys not, Karen Carpenter sung. She doesn't play at country bars, so I know it's in my head. Like, why do birds suddenly appear? And then I was like, Jim Carrey, you know, with the eyeballs. I was trying to play it cool. But my first honest reaction when I saw my husband, Rob, was, there you are. It was the weirdest just knowing. Anyway, so I did all kinds of, you know, took my hair out of the ponytail, all the things to get his attention. Anyway, we exchanged numbers finally, trying to fast forward a little bit. But I remember telling him, like, a lot of girls need approval from their dad. I'm like, so my therapist has to, like, say you're okay. Why didn't you run? Like, that was your chance, man. So he got anointed, and anyway, so we started pointing our feet further and further towards Christ. We actually, we got married. We ended up at a church that we would go to for 20 years, where, you know, we got baptized, but dedicated our first son, Kyle, there, went there every Sunday. And I remember being approached by a film company called, I don't know if you guys are familiar with Movie Guide. Movie Guide's a great thing. They, like, they'll analyze films for spiritual redemptive value. So before you go, you'll know if it's got pagan values or spiritual redemptive value. But they asked me to present at their award shows, and then they, Ted goes, hey, meet me at the Sheraton Hilton. I got some people I want you to meet. And I meet with this group, and they're like, Ted tells us you have a story inside of you. And I was like, oh, he does he? And it was Broadman Holman, the publishing company. You know, they do things like Bibles. Lifeway Christian bookstore, and they asked me to write a book about my story. And I remember thinking, what am I going to write about? And I just remember asking God, you know, what do you want me to say? And I, as a new Christian, I still feel like a new Christian. I'm not one to come up and quote verses and things like that, but I know that my story is, my testimony is powerful. And so I decided to write it on breaking the perfect 10. How I had broken all of God's 10 commandments trying to be the Hollywood perfect 10. And when Rob and I had our first child, Kyle, who was here a second ago, but he left. I don't know what that means. When Kyle was born, I remember bringing him home from the hospital and sitting on a rocking, his little glider, and the window, the blinds were open, and it was a beautiful night. You see the stars, everything. And I remember looking up into the heavens and just getting so emotional. Like, here's this beautiful life. And I said, God, I'm so sorry. And I realized now, when I was pregnant that first time, that he had given me a gift. I thought it was like the worst thing. I'm like, oh, this is terrible. He was giving me a gift. But in my ignorance, I wadded that gift up and threw it back in his face. And then he blessed me with this beautiful, healthy baby boy sitting right here. And that is, I thought I knew God's grace and mercy until that moment. That's when I truly knew his grace and mercy, that I was given that second chance. I almost lost my ability to have children and everything because of it. And so that is just my, I guess, message would be, don't wait until you're desperate. You know, a lot of people wait to turn to God when God's all you got. And that's just not the way to go. You know, I wish I had listened to all of those hints and everything sooner. I would have saved myself and a lot of people a lot of hurt. But I do believe that, you know, just don't wait. Keep in relationship with him and don't wait. So I don't know if you guys know Jelly Roll, but it's kind of like that verse of his song, you know, don't expect a savior when you only ask for a favor or something like that. I forget the verse, but it's so good, right? So that is my...
exactly clean, so. But you said you didn't mind. So I just want to say really quickly, Lindsay Graham, when I first heard your name, I was like, does everybody say that to you? Are you related to the senator? I'm like, I hope not. Oh, you are? I'm sorry. That proves what I was just gonna say. She's intense, man. I just met her a few weeks back. I didn't know her story. And when Lisa said, yeah, the Patriot Barbie, they want to come and use the theater. And I'm like, who's that, right? She's the gal that went to the school board meeting dressed as a cat. I'm like, what? I was like, was it Halloween? And Lisa goes, no. I'm like, she just went to the school board meeting dressed as a cat. I'm like, why? Well, I'm sure she'll tell you why, but I just wanted to tell you she's feisty, she's intense, and there's such a need for what you're doing out there, and everybody's so proud of you for what you're doing. Lindsay Graham.
Without writing a speech. So I was like, Lord, this is totally yours. Like, totally. No notes. Tracy, wow, way to set the emotional bar real high. It was cool. I've known Tracy for a couple years now and didn't know any of that. Haven't read your book. Totally gonna go read it now, so, because I feel like crying. But we have so many similarities, and I think that it's a reflection of God and his character and what he looks like if we're really paying attention. When I was young, I had the opposite childhood. I had a beautiful family life. I had married parents and two brothers, and we had plenty of money, and everything was great. When people say, what was your childhood like? I'm like, perfect, that's it, just perfect, it's fine. But I always had this desire because, you know, we tell God what we want to do. I told God, I'm gonna be a famous actress. Or I'm gonna be a singer. Either way, I'm gonna be on stage, I'm gonna be famous, whatever, for whatever reason. And that was the plan my whole entire life. And as I got older, I remember thinking, how does one get famous, right? Let's go to Hollywood or whatever. If you're Natalie Portman, you fall down some stairs and a director's like, you're perfect. And I remember seeing that going, what else am I gonna go fall down some stairs? Okay. Now, that was the desire of my heart, was to be an actress or a singer, to perform, to be famous. Who knows why anyone wants to be famous, but Psalm 37:4 says that if you love the Lord your God, he will give you the desires of your heart, right? If you follow him, if you believe in him. And so keeping that tucked away over here, knowing that who I thought I wanted to be as a child, I will tell you that Clearly, I'm not a famous actress or a singer. Nor am I related to Lindsey Graham, the famous politician. Like, no fame whatsoever. And stopped seeking it somewhere in my 20s. But I know that God planted that seed somewhere. And that seed is here, because look it, I am on a stage. And thank you. I'm on a stage, I'm not singing, I'm not acting, I'm not doing what I thought I would be doing, but I'm doing what God said. You have that desire for it, but I'm gonna make sure that you're glorifying me when you do it. So wipe the whole actress thing away, because that ain't gonna happen. Because I would have definitely cast and couched. I lost my morality in my 20s. Grew up in a Christian conservative home, was taught the Bible, went to church every Sunday, went to youth group, sang in the church choir, acted in the church drama, same thing on repeat in the school, all through high school, church and choir, drama, thespian, and was probably doing what God had planned, which is seeding, sowing these little seeds for being able to be up on a stage and not be shy or scared or nervous. And there really is no rational reason that I can give you why a teenage girl who didn't wear makeup, didn't do her hair, literally wore her brother's jeans and Stussy t-shirts to school, didn't cuss, didn't smoke cigarettes, didn't do nothing. No, I'm a good girl. I read the Bible and I go to church. Why she went so psycho in her 20s? Like, I went full crazy. I actually remember sitting in places like this at church and hearing women who had come out of prostitution and sex trafficking, and they had these devastating but glorifying testimonies and everything they'd been through, and I went, well, that's never gonna be me, because I am boring and I just have lived this great little Christian life. Like, I don't really have a testimony. And God was like, I could hear him go, ha ha ha. And, oh, Lindsay, here's some meth. Not kidding. Yeah, that was not God. Yeah, let's clarify. So, somewhere in that era, because of my personality, because I am who God created me, I love everything, I love to try everything, I love to live life to the fullest, I decided to literally try everything. And so I went from being this beautiful Christian, and now here's what I think God was doing. What I think he was doing was flicking me off my pedestal, right? How do I reach people in Christianity and share my testimony if my testimony is always going to be, well, I've been a better Christian than you my entire life, so trust me when I know what the Bible says. Like, people don't relate to that. And if you're a great Christian and you can get people to relate to that, by all means. But I was becoming a hoity-toity little thing. And so flick went the Lord. And in my 20s, I went from that to, I'm a flight attendant. I want to have some fun on the weekends. I'm going to fly to Vegas. That's my party. I'm going to fly to Vegas. And that turned into drinking underage, of course, because you actually only have to be 20 to be a flight attendant. So everyone just assumed I was 21 and I would get free drinks. That turned into sampling little drugs here and there and sampling cocaine, which is insane. I'm gonna try cocaine. I don't know who thinks that. And that turned into losing that job as a flight attendant because of my radical partying. Getting fired and finding myself, you know, now a complete party girl, but completely desolate and broke. And that is where my stripper friend found me and said, come to the bar on Friday and I'll introduce you to some guys and you'll get free drinks and, you know, then you can still party without having to fund it. And I will not go into the details, but basically within, you know, 2 hours of being there, the owner was asking me to audition to be a dancer. And I was like, well, I'm broke, so here's my motto, why not? And so just like that, I became a stripper. Like, I have the Jesus fish tattooed on my ankle, and now I'm a stripper. And mind you, like, during this time, I'm well aware the Lord does not like this But I'm just gonna, Lord, let me just do this. I'm gonna get it out of my system and I'll be back, don't worry. And I knew that what I was doing was wrong, and yet I kind of was like, oh, I know too much. I know that God will forgive me. I know too well that he'll forgive me. So let me just do this, and then when I come back, he'll forgive me. Totally abused his grace, totally. So now a very wealthy attorney flies a few girls to Reno. And on that Reno trip, these girls are meth addicts, and they invite me to do meth. And what do you think my response is? Why not? And when people tell you about the dangers of meth and just trying it, they mean it. Instant meth addict. Lost a lot of weight, was probably very close to potentially being hospitalized or dead. Dancing just to, now no longer to supply like my livelihood, but just to supply my drug addiction. God uses sometimes really weird and strange people and events in your life to like shift you. And at this point in my life, he used someone horrible to shift me. And this man is very much going to hell, I believe. And very much a wolf in sheep's clothing. But at this time in my life, God used him. And I don't even think he realizes. I met him at church. He looked like the kind of guy I should marry. Handsome, wealthy, well-dressed, well-mannered. Yes, by the way, in case you didn't catch it, I was going to church while I was a meth addict dancer. That's how much I still, like God still had me. And very quickly got into a relationship with this man who turned out to be abusive, verbally, emotionally, and physically. And I spent 3 years being abused by this man, almost to my death, strangulation, multiple police calls on me. I was arrested one time for an altercation with him. My life's like, whoa, it went from obviously this amazing, good Christian, you know, perfect person to who is this unrecognizable female? But here's what God did. I saw the life that I knew that I originally had wanted, which was to be married and to have kids and the whole American dream. Well, the girl that I was not gonna get that. And so in order to pursue what I really knew God wanted, I needed to stop what I was doing. And so here I was with a man who I thought he had totally manipulated and brainwashed and gaslighted me into believing that he was still kind of like the ideal mate. And I said, okay, I'm gonna stop dancing. I gotta stop doing that. That's not cohesive for like someday getting married. And then I decided I'm going to stop doing drugs because he wants me to, obviously, and I should. So this is where God takes credit, okay? I was not gonna allow a man to tell me that he had freed me from drugs. I snuck drugs. So I told him I quit, kept sneaking drugs, and continued to be a drug addict. Until one day, God actually found me in my work, tweaking out, freaking out, completely berserk. And I just, you know, I don't know if you, when people say, I heard God, I'm like, I didn't hear him. I just felt him say, you're done. You're done. And I was like, no, Lord, I just bought a whole stash. Nope, you're done. And I was like, all right, well, that sucks. Took my drugs, dumped them in the sink of my work, grabbed the water faucet. Are you sure? Okay. Turned the water on and washed them. I never did meth again. Never. That was all gone. Now, here's where it gets so good. Lord, why did you let me do all these things? Oh my gosh. Oh, I skipped a whole part in there. Whole part. I'm gonna come back to Lord, why did you do all this stuff, right? Somewhere in between quitting the Lord letting me quit drugs. Just like Tracy. And man, we really need our men to step up in America and stop asking women to kill their babies. I got pregnant with his baby. And he manipulated and gaslit me into having an abortion. My senior project in high school was why abortion is murder. That is how twisted my mind was. And I was dropped off at the clinic, I was picked up at the clinic, and I will not go into details about how this man treated me after forcing me to do this on my birthday, but it was, it will always be, always, forget drugs, forget dancing, it'll always be the one thing in my life that I cannot take back, and I cannot ever let go of the hurt, right? I know I'm forgiven, I forgive myself, that's why I can talk about it. I know that God forgives me, but when you have children, like I have children now, three, I now look at those children and I realize one of you is not here. And I can't wait to see that baby in heaven, but now do you kind of see what happened between the age of like 20 and 23? We've got a whole mess of things. I'm like, all right, Lord, I definitely have a testimony now. And here's what's beautiful. I was finally freed from that man. He actually made me feel so guilty for killing our baby that one night I called him and said, I am not doing well. I'm not doing well with this. I need help. And he said, I'm at church. Call somebody else. And what I didn't do was call somebody else. What I did do is say, you know what? I'm not going to be a problem for anyone anymore. And took my little allergy pills that said drowsy, and I took every single one of them and said, no one's gonna worry about me anymore. This, we're done. You can go to church and you can have your fun, and I won't be here when you get back. And praise the Lord that I was rushed to the hospital and completely saved. And even after all of this, I knew that God saved me from these things, but I still wasn't all in with like my testimony, right? I mean, who's gonna walk around being like, ah, wait till you're what I did in my 20s, all the things I just told you. That's not a casual conversation. So I don't know how the Lord is gonna use these things to be my ministry, to help other people. But I will tell you this, 6 months after quitting meth, I was on a date in a movie theater and I walked up to the bathroom. And when I walked in the restroom, I looked over at the woman at the mirror and I'm like, you are tweaking out. And I would never have known that 9 months ago, never. But I know that you're tweaking out. And I went into the restroom and I, you know, did my thing, came out. And I looked at her in the mirror and I debated with God what I should do or if I should mind my own business, washed my hands, went to the door, grabbed the handle, and like Holy Spirit once again was like, nope. And I turned around and I had no idea what to say to this woman. And all I did was walk up and say, I know what you're doing because I used to do it too. And she denied it and she denied it and denied it. And I said, I just want to tell you that God can free you from this because I'm free from it completely, not just 6 months ago. And I said, can I please pray for you? This is so out of character, you guys. Like, even when I was a good Christian, I wasn't like, let me pray for you. I was just a, you know, rule-following Christian. So I said, let me pray for you. So she let me pray for her. She cried. She gave me her name and number, which I still have memorized to this day, by the way. It's not her number. I texted, like, a month ago. Is this Tiffany? No. I prayed for her. She cried. She gave me her number. We left. And I went, all right, I think that's why the Lord does what he does, right? I couldn't be here to save this woman if I hadn't been through what I've been through. Right. So the next day, I actually called her number and a woman answered the phone. And I said, is Tiffany there? And she said, no. And I said, okay, I'll try back later. And she goes, is this the girl from the bathroom? And I was like, yes. She said, this is Tiffany's mom. And Tiffany came home yesterday from the mall and said that an angel came to her in the bathroom and told her that God wanted her to quit doing drugs. And so she's... And she said, she's not available because she is sleeping off her drugs and we're taking her to rehab tomorrow. And I was like, and I realize now, I still didn't realize then, I realized God had used me, but I didn't realize how everything we do, every pain we go through, everything God allows, everything we think is God hating us, becomes something that helps someone else. And that's what we're built for, is to help each other, right? And so I went about my life. I got married. I had my three kids. I continued to be this amazing lukewarm Christian. Totally lukewarm. So lukewarm. And in 2020, when the government locked us down, this is where I believe, I've been asked on podcasts multiple times, when did you give your life to the Lord? I'm like, well, probably this time. Also this one time in my aunt's living room, watching Trinity Broadcasting Network. And then I would say also again in 2020.
Woo!
Yeah. 2020, we all got locked down. I'm just a stubborn, hard-headed woman. God knows who I am, right? You're not shut. I can't stay shut down. I'm gonna go bankrupt. I'm gonna lose my business. This doesn't make sense. Doesn't make sense. I was not political, not at all. I didn't understand. COVID was a scamdemic, and it's all the government. I'm like, whatever. I'm not like that now, but I'm gonna lose my livelihood if I don't open. So I'm opening. They can kick rocks. And so I defied the government. I was annihilated by the government every single day for, 10 days straight. The government threatened to throw me in jail, arrest me, fine me, which they did, take away my three children. I mean, kick me out of my building, you name it. If there's a government agency involved in violating lockdowns, they have my number. And I continue to stand up against them, and I don't know why. I get asked, how are you so strong? I'm like, I don't know. I just was like, you're bluffing. Hearted. God made me. And I'm so thankful. My dad is like, oh, you're hard-headed. I'm like, I defy the government lockdowns. Came in handy, didn't it? Yeah. And so what happened after that, being literally on the news in like Iran, and I mean, seriously, like I had people writing me in German, writing me emails. I'm like, I'm not German. Like, how could I come on your show?
Yeah.
And was thrust into the spotlight. Not the fame. Let me tell you that I was seeking Lord when I was younger. And yet there it was. And I was completely annihilated by the left. And they wasted no time at all, making it very clear that here's the line. And if you're a liberal or a Democrat or a leftist, you're a murderer and you're killing people. And shame on you, and you should die. I hope your kids die. And if you're over here on the right, you're fighting for freedom. You're a hero. And I'm like, all right, I'm gonna go over here. This is where I belong. Come on, folks. But I became accidentally like this conservative icon, which I was conservative, but I didn't care to be conservative. So this was all very like, okay, well, yeah, I am actually a Republican, but I guess I'm a hardcore one now. The George Floyd riots started, and because I was in the news, the BLM activists and Antifa in Oregon posted online, the first place you need to burn down is Glamour Salon, and kick Lindsey Graham's butt. And so everyone started sharing that to me, and I was like, oh Lord, I just fought the government for 2 weeks. Now I gotta fight little white liberals. Come on. I don't know who everyone's afraid of. Literally, they are little white liberals being like, Black Lives Matter. I'm like, you're white. Why don't you let the blacks speak? So I did a call to arms, and 400 people showed up outside my salon. ARs, veterans, military, ex-police, biker gangs. I was like, okay. I applaud this toxic masculinity right now. There were so many people, we actually spread out outside of the whole downtown Salem. I had business owners calling, will you send some guys? I'm like, yeah, let me get my ops. Let me put my AR down real quick. Okay, so then of course, besides being like a murderer and a grifter and all the leftist names, now I was a white supremacist and a white nationalist and a murderer and a racist. And then the transphobe comes stuff later when I do the cat thing. That came later. Right now I'm just this set of things. I will become these later. And so we got, like, it's funny now. But if you read my book, you'll see that it's not funny. It'll be like the biggest tearjerker part of the book, probably. They just destroyed us. I mean, they destroyed my life. I had 6 businesses in Oregon. They canceled every single business. I mean, when I say canceled, hate mail via text, phone call, email, Facebook, Instagram, Yelp, wow. Google, all 7 platforms, nonstop, on repeat, times 6 businesses. And that doesn't even count the text messages I was getting from people I had done their hair for 10 years saying, I didn't realize you were a Trump supporter, you're a racist, B, don't, I'll never be back in your chair. Oh, wow, okay. I actually didn't say I voted for Trump, but I did. So what happened was, that year specifically was the worst year that God could have allowed my complete and utter demise, like the worst. I had a 25 chair salon and they were full. I had launched a hair extension company and invested $50,000 and built an online platform. It was growing rapidly. We had a gym that my husband had opened, not a little gym, a gym, like a Planet Fitness, a gym. We had opened it a month prior to lockdowns. And we had 3 tanning salons that we had purchased in the last year. We had just built a new home. It was our forever home on property and it was beautiful. And I had just had my 3rd baby. So I bought a new SUV to cart all my kids around. So we had exhausted all of our financial resources into building what would now be like our life. And we could just sail easy and like, everything's good. Everything is perfect, let's go. And then lockdowns and then cancel culture. And we lost every single thing in Oregon. We had to sell our house. We had to close my salon, not even sell it. No one would buy it, close it. We put $100,000 into remodeling the salon that year too. So yeah, closed, sold the gym to the partner and sold the Tanner Publics to other franchise owners because our name was so slandered, we couldn't do business. So I sat in my brand new SUV in my driveway in Oregon and I just literally had to comprehend like, it's over. Everything I've been doing for 20 years up until this point, the worst point ever, is over. I'll never rebuild my salon. All my stylists left, by the way, all 25 of them, because I was a racist. We were done. Like everything that we knew was done. All we knew was we can't survive here and we've got to start over and we've got to get somewhere safe. Arizona. And so in my car, in a very, very devastating, moment in my life, I realized God has his hand in this. And so am I angry at God for taking everything away from me, everything I've worked for, gone? Or do I truly believe that he loves me, he has what's best for me, and he has a plan?
Yes.
This is what we're taught, right?
Yes.
Which is it? He's this horrible, evil God that just destroyed my life? Or, Lord, if you're taking away all of this, what could you possibly have for me?
Yes.
And I chose to be excited, literally excited. If my life was this good and he's wiping it out for something else, oh, the next phase is going to be better. I can't wait. So I chose at that moment, I chose real faith, not Bible faith, not the scripture says faith, not I go to church faith, I sing in the church choir. I have real faith that when it's Job, when you are Job in your life and you have no reason to praise God, I praise God. And I did. I praised him and I said, all right, let's do this, bro. What do you got? So we moved to Arizona. We started over. I went through an identity crisis because I was like, I'm not a boss babe anymore. I went from making 250 grand a year to like being a stay-at-home mom. Lord, give me happiness in here. No job. We had no idea what we were going to do in Arizona. We tried a couple things. You'll read in my book. We tried a couple things. They weren't working. About the year mark of being down here, God told me through four people distinctly within a 12-hour period, write a book. And just like Tracy, I was like, what am I going to write about? Like, me defying government lockdowns is like a 10-day period of my life. And then me being the crazy in my 20s has nothing to do with anything people want to hear. And yet, I obeyed, right? Because I did say, I'll do whatever you want, let's go. So I sat down at my computer and I wrote my book. And what it was the Lord saying, you're suffering an identity crisis, let me tell you who you are. You are not a boss babe. You are not a salon owner. You're not even really Patriot Barbie. You are mine. And here is what I have decided for you. And I wrote, as I was sitting there writing, people would say, how did you get to be so brave to defy lockdowns? And I would think to myself, well, you have no idea how much I've been through. Like, I definitely better be strong after all of that stuff, right? Amen. So as I'm writing this book, I'm seeing my hands trying to type about being a dancer and a meth addict and an abortion, and I'm going, my dad is gonna read this book. We'll skip over that detailed part, but God's like, write it. You gotta write it, it's your story. And I was like, okay. I'm telling you right now, hand to God, I've actually never read my book all the way through. Mm-hmm. I sat there, I wrote it, I sent it to someone and said, edit it, I rearranged the chapters, and then I sent it to print. I've literally never read it from front to back. When people are like, oh, I'm in chapter 6, I'm like, all right, what's chapter 6? Oh, yeah, it's a good one. Here's some tissues. I just blindly obeyed and discovered, like, everything that I just said in the last hour, which is, I get to enjoy the desires of my heart, which is to be up here speaking with a microphone. I love attention. Love it, right? People are so afraid to say that. Why did I want to be famous? I love attention. I love people. I love presenting and performing, and I love when people love me. God made me that way. And now I get to be exactly who I want to be. I get to enjoy it, and yet he's like, but you're doing it for my glory. You're not doing it for a paycheck. You're not doing it for an album, whatever. What do you even call it? What do you call it when you get an album, when Sony signs you?
A record deal.
See, I could never have been a music artist. I'm like, you know, one of those things, you know, where I sign. Yeah. I did do some commercial acting, though, in Oregon. I was in a few commercials, and I rocked it. But I see full circle the last 2 years since I wrote the book and kind of downloaded, like, all right, Lord, you want something for me, and I literally don't know what it is, but I agree to follow. And so when I finished the book, I put it on the universe. I stopped pursuing a real estate career, which is what I thought I needed to do. I stopped trying to recreate my hair brand. And it was hilarious because I was like, what are you going to do? I'm like, I'm going to sit here and I'm going to wait. And God's going to do whatever he does. He's going to open doors and I'm going to walk through them. Amen. And Satan's going to open doors. I'm going to walk through those and realize I'm wrong, and I'm going to go back out. And then I'm going to try to stay on track. And you wouldn't believe, like, some of the phone calls and opportunities that come up that I'm like, Lord, this is totally you. My whole life is like, Lord, this is totally you every day. Because, again, people ask, what's the goal? What's next? And I'm like, I don't know. What's that? I gotta wake up tomorrow and see what God's doing. And it's joyful. I've fallen into my purpose accidentally, because God said, you're too distracted making money up here being a hairstylist and not changing, not even remotely expanding the kingdom of heaven. So you want a microphone? Fine. I'm gonna take everything away from you, and then you're gonna obey me, and then I'll give you a microphone, but here's what you're gonna say. And that's what I keep doing, because that's what I keep saying. So 5 more points and then I'm just kidding. I think that's it. Have I said everything, Lord, that I need to say? When the time comes that you are afraid of losing something, a job, a friendship, family member, an uncomfortable situation, and you want to just keep the peace and stay quiet, but you hear God saying, no, you need to speak up and speak truth. I don't want to lose my job. Let me tell you that it's the best thing ever. Getting canceled is like the badge of honor, and no amount of money or boss babeness or notoriety in Salem, Oregon, I would never go back to it in a million years. I would rather wake up every single day knowing and trusting that God is doing with me what he wants to do with me than to get up and just go through the motions every day, make a paycheck, raise my kids, rinse and repeat. I get to wake up every day with the joy and the excitement of, like, literally God is laying out his path, and as long as I stay focused and I follow, I'm in his purpose, and that is so much more meaningful. Mm-hmm.